And welcome back to Inclusive Design 24 2019, brought to you in partnership with our Gold supporters, Barclays Access and Intopia. Don't forget, you can subscribe to Inclusive Design 24 on YouTube by visiting youtube.com/inclusivedesign24 and hitting the subscribe button. You can also follow ID24Conf on Twitter. And if you have questions for the presenters, tweet them using the ID24 hashtag and we'll ask them at the end of the session. And a reminder that ID24 is a respectful community with a code of conduct available on our website.
For those of you who are listening or watching in from around the world, hello to those of you who've told us you're in Los Angeles and Bangalore. It's great to have you tuning in. Please do tweet us and let us know where in the world you are if you're watching. We do have a slight apology to make, though. Unfortunately, we're having a technical problem with our caption stream at the moment. We'll try to get that sorted out as quickly as possible. And if you're watching this on archive, hopefully it will be sorted out as you are watching. But without any more ado, I'd like to hand over to Carie Fisher, who's going to be talking about accessible design patterns from the ground up. Carie.
Thank you very much. Before I begin, I just want to thank the ID24 team again for the opportunity to speak tonight. I'm very honored to be part of such a fantastic lineup this year, so thank you. So everyone, welcome to the talk, Accessible Patterns from the Ground Up. When we talk about digital accessibility, for some people it can be very difficult or frustrating, but it doesn't have to be. By making some small changes to our everyday workflow, you can have a huge impact on making the digital world more inclusive without crushing your creativity or sacrificing your sanity. In this talk, I'll walk through the process of creating an accessible pattern from design to development while focusing on accessibility best practices and tools at each step. I'll start with the wireframe, process that into design, and then we'll translate that design into code. And then at the end, we'll show a little video snippet of a test. So like the host just said, my name is Carie Fisher. I'm the other Carie Fisher. I'm a senior accessibility consultant at DQ, and I've been building websites professionally from about like the early 2000s, primarily with CMSs like Drupal and WordPress. I'm a passionate person about front-end development, accessibility, and promoting diversity in the tech world. DQ Systems, if you haven't heard about them before, DQ is a company that specializes in digital accessibility. We help other companies make their websites and mobile applications more accessible by providing educational resources, training, audits, and a suite of tools to help automate accessibility reviews. So today we're going to talk about the process of going from an accessible pattern idea to the final product, and we'll chat about the four stages along the way as we go through our accessibility journey of awareness, knowledge, practice, and understanding. Just so you know, this talk was inspired by the variety of students I've trained in the past for accessibility and addresses some of those typical questions I get during these beginner trainings. It's good to mention that while we go through the process outlined on these slides, that one size does not fit all. So based on your team size or your budgetary constraints, you may be able to do one piece and hand it off to somebody, another team member, or maybe you need an outside consultant to help you with some of these things. Maybe you don't need all the tools that we outline or the steps that we outline or that I outline here tonight, and that's okay. It's more important that you find something that works for you and your team than abandoning accessibility altogether. So this talk is meant to help you kind of start that initial internal conversation and go from there. All right, so moving on. As any good farmer or gardener knows, before you plant any seeds, you must prep the soil. So let's chat a little bit about stage one or accessibility awareness. So before we can fix a problem, we have to realize that it is a problem, right? So typically stage one, this awareness, you're brand new to digital accessibility, or you're still just trying to understand what it is and how you can implement these changes in your daily workflow. You may be aware that there is a set of digital accessibility guidelines that other designers and developers follow, but you're kind of a bit hazy on what it means in a practical sense. So again, if you're new to the field of accessibility, the following slides in this section will be help you give a deeper foundation before we go into the pattern workflow. But if you're less new to accessibility, you might know some of this already, but it's important that we review it quickly so we can all kind of start off on the roughly on the same level. I'm amazed every training, it seems like people have not heard of this acronym or this numeronym accessibility, it's A11Y. A11 letters and Y. So I'm just pointing that out in case you see that hashtag thrown around a bit on Twitter. But it's about designing and building your digital offerings in such a way that regardless of a person's mental or physical ability, they could still interact with your website, app, or electronic document in a meaningful and equal way. According to the World Health Organization, 1 billion people, or 15% of the world's population, self-identify as having a disability. Of course, that number, the original number, is a bit deceiving because if you consider people who don't identify as having a disability, but who could benefit from accessible websites and apps, that number jumps way higher. For example, someone with a temporary disability like a broken wrist, situationally disabled like glare on a device screen, mildly disabled, hard of hearing, maybe colorblind, or even English as a second language, and you need just a little bit more time to process. All of those groups could also benefit from accessible websites. If we focus on the US alone, we have over 56 million people, or roughly 19% of the population, who identify, again, self-identify as being disabled. If you think about this in other terms, this is the entire population of California plus New York combined. Can you imagine someone saying, okay, let's develop a website, but exclude California and New York? Like, that wouldn't happen, probably, hopefully not. But when we talk about beyond just the people who self-identify as being disabled, we have almost 40 million people, or 13% of the population, who are over the age of 65 and could also benefit from accessible websites due to loss of hearing, eyesight, motor control, decreased cognition. Again, this is the same as the entire population of Texas plus Illinois. This number is also expected to double in the next 20 years, and it'll continue to grow as people live longer and technology becomes even more prevalent and important to our daily lives. In total, the accessibility covers over 96 million, or 32% of the US population alone. And I know that I'm focused on the US here, and I think that we have applicable numbers or throughout different countries as well. So I'd have to get some harder numbers on that for that. But very similar situations, I believe, in most countries. So if this is a big percentage, and if you're ignoring this collective demographic, you're losing up to 32% of your potential users. We talk about users a lot, but we don't really talk about the money sometimes. And I think that a big business case is that when we talk about people with disabilities, and we talk about this group of 65 or older, or we talk about this group that has maybe doesn't identify, self-identify as being disabled, but could benefit from accessible websites. We've got a lot of income that we're talking about here. We're talking about an annual aggregate annual income of over $1 trillion, and that's in the US alone, and over $200 billion that they can see spend as they see fit. So the long story short, if your company is spending lots of money on things like SEO or marketing, but not addressing accessibility needs for their users, they're missing out on both the number of users and their money. So again, those are kind of rough numbers, just kind of give you the idea that this is kind of a big thing, both in terms of business and in terms of users. So those are the rough numbers. But what about the regulations related to accessibility? This is where the Web Content Accessibility Guidelines come into play. WCAG was developed through the W3C process in cooperation with individuals and organizations around the world, with the goal of providing a single shared standard for web content accessibility that meets the needs of individuals, organizations, and governments internationally. These WCAG guidelines are intended to aid designers and developers with creating web accessible websites and apps. But it can get really technical really fast. So for beginners, I try to focus on those actionable parts of the guidelines, namely the POR concepts. So that's perceivable, operable, understandable, and robust. This acronym POR is not about rigidly adhering to these hard and fast rules, but it's more about understanding and meeting the diverse needs of our users. It's important to note that each facet of POR is interconnected. So it's more accurate to show it as kind of like a symbiotic relationship where they're all working together, like this illustration shows. Again, if you kind of break it down a little bit more, for perceivable, you might ask questions like, is there anything on our website or app that a person with a disability would not be able to perceive? So an example would be like adding text alternatives to non-decorative images, or adding captions to transcripts or videos, to videos, or making sure that the color is not the only method of conveying meaning. The second category is operable, where users must be able to operate the interface. The interface cannot require interaction that a user cannot perform. So some examples would be like using keyboard only navigation, making sure that that works on your website or app, or in an app sense, I guess that would be touch, or making sure that your slideshows have all the controls shown or your media has all the controls shown, giving you enough time to fill out a form. Third category is understandable. So users must be able to understand the information as well as the operation of the user interface. So the content or operation cannot be beyond their understanding. So we just want to make sure that things are written clearly. Ninth grade level is usually what we kind of aim at. And don't use a $10 word when a $1 word would do. And the last is robust. Oops, went down too far. So basically, we're making sure that it can work. Does your website or your app, does it work on multiple devices and modalities? All right, that's a quick version of that. So we've kind of covered the number of people needing accessible websites and apps, the amount of money they have to spend, and we also kind of briefly talked about the international set of rules already well thought out with people in mind, the WCAG guidelines. So we planted that seed, right? So now we're on to stage two of knowledge. So at this stage, we're aware already of digital accessibility and digital inequality at some level, and some regulations, just like we just talked about, WCAG and POR principles. But what else can you help to make your designs more inclusive? So now we're going to focus on the design aspect of this. So before you even pick up your pencil or open your digital design program of choice, you need to keep a couple things in mind. First up are accessibility heuristics. So heuristics are accessibility specific rules that are inspired by WCAG, and they're built for the purpose of evaluating design assets for accessibility. So these rules help designers integrate accessibility considerations into their work. This particular list that I'm showing right here was developed by DQ with Denis Boudreau, Aparna Passi, and Kaylin Greer at DQ again. But this is only one. You can decide, you know, to add your own internally, or there's other resources as well. This breaks it down. For instance, one of the heuristics here is contrast and legibility. And you would look at the design and ask questions like, is information conveyed by means other than just color alone? Is the foreground background contrast ratio of the text at least 4.5:1 or 3:1 for large text? Is the design exempt from images with embedded text in them? Is line spacing set to at least 1.5 in paragraphs and twice as much between them? Are selected typefaces easy to read, or do they render properly on mobile? So beyond the checklist, we have this kind of rating system as well. So that's kind of showing on that second page, right? That's on the screen right now. So beyond that, you can choose, you can look at the design asset or user interface and see if it successfully integrates the concept of said heuristic. And then you can decide, yes, it goes above and beyond, or it just passes, or maybe it doesn't pass, and then there's also not applicable. There's a link right there. Hopefully we can get somebody to grab that. And oh, I was going to say too, we have at the very end of the presentation, I'll have a link to all the resources. So don't worry too much if you miss this one right now. But beyond heuristics, we can also think about personas as well. Personas answer the question, who are we designing and developing for? And they help align strategy and goals to specific user groups. The user persona can be formal or informal, on paper or in your head. It is important when planning a new website or app to keep people of varying backgrounds, ethnicities, genders, ages, technical abilities, and disabilities as part of your personas. So when you're working towards meeting a realistic variety of perspectives and needs. The purpose of personas is to create reliable and realistic representations of your key audience segment for reference. These representations should be based on qualitative and some quantitative user research and web analytics whenever possible. Personas help focus decisions surrounding the site components by adding a layer of real-world consideration to the conversation. They also offer a quick and inexpensive way to test and prioritize these features throughout the development process. I'm showing here the UK Home Office. There's a link to that as well. And again, this reference will be at the end as well. I really like these because they kind of get people in that mindset when we do workshops where they can kind of decide, instead of thinking about all the accessibility issues and WCAG and all the regulations and all this, they can just focus on one spectrum, one kind of task at a time, like let's say low vision. And so they can look at these five do's and five don'ts for only low vision, and then they can go and assess a site, and then they kind of get that their minds kind of going a little bit. It is important to point out that personas are not based on real people or stereotypes. They're not a substitute for user testing, and they're only useful if they're actually used. They should be based on real data. They should be supported by throughout all departments, and also communicated early and often. So I kind of think of them as a tool set to create empathy. But there is a gray area, so definitely don't take them to heart. It's just, again, a way to start thinking about that. All right, so that was kind of stage two for design. So that was the knowledge part. So armed with some more accessibility design knowledge, we move on to that stage three of practicing. So feeling more confident in the knowledge of digital accessibility rules and best practices, you can build that knowledge into your design process. So when about 15 years ago, when the word usability came out, that was like kind of a big design buzzword for teams to strive for. But like no one today says, make sure it's usable. That's just inherent. So the UX discipline doesn't think about making sure something is usable now, because that's just intrinsic to design. And that's kind of what we're striving for accessibility in the long term, that it's just part of the normal workflow. It's not even something you talk about anymore. That's the goal, right, at the end of this. And hopefully less than 15 years from now that we'll have that, and it'll just be built into everybody's workflow. But learning to design accessibly is habitually the same as learning to design usably. So incorporating both heuristics, personas, and any other methods to kind of grow this like prowess and knowledge over time. All right, so here we have lo-fi and hi-fi and some general accessibility considerations at each. So for lo-fi, we're doing like rapid exploration, iterative fidelity. We're gonna allow design to work through different combinations of ideas fairly cheaply. Here we'll start to see things like tab order, roles, buttons worked out. Hi-fi is the most expensive and detailed fidelity. This will likely be the representation of the desired end state of the product. Here you'll see things like color, spacing, accessible names, and custom focuses. I wanted to say also that some of this information we've got from Aaron Perlman, our lead designer at DQ. He developed a few of these slides, so I wanted to give him a shout out. The same for right here on the pattern design. We're gonna talk about making an image card that flips when you click it. And we have a modified annotation system that Jack Nicolai, originally from Adobe, created. And then of course, Aaron, our lead designer, kind of modified a little bit. So I wanted to do a shout out there to that, to give them the credit for that part. So letting me use this in this publication here. So these symbols include things like E and L and red teardrops to indicate buttons or links, green comment bubbles to add specific accessibility information like accessible names, and a blue square symbol to indicate tab order. So you can see here on my image card that we have a lo-fi flip image card without annotations. You can just see the annotations there that we're gonna use in the next slide. So we have the same lo-fi, but now we have some of these annotations applied. Again, depending on your design team and how familiar they are with accessibility, or sometimes I know companies have like a role, it's like a UX engineer, which would be kind of an in-between or like a hybrid between design and front-end development. Somewhere in that middle gray area, that would be this perfect thing for them, because what they're doing is they're taking the design and things that the designers are already thinking about. They're thinking in their mind, like this is a hover, this is a click, that sort of thing, this is a button. Even if they're not using those words specifically, they know the functionality as well as what it's going to look like, right? So this is just a way to enhance that knowledge that's already going on, that conversation that's already going on, but in a visual way that we're being able to communicate between the design team and the dev team. I joke around sometimes. I'm like, you don't want to let your developers design anything. So this would be a very good place where designers can keep that that image and that vision, and not letting the developers make some of these decisions for them. So again, we have some tab stops. We have an alpha, which does the whole card. The first tab stop after that would be the edit button. We have some typical things like the heights and things that you normally see anyway. Then we also have button indications. And then in this case, our accessible name would be the edit and then the flip card name. This is the high fidelity version of this. So again, very similar to what we saw before, except this time we have a little bit more information about what's the default focus. In this case, the default focus is not the flip information. It's going to be the card with the image. I forgot to mention this one right here too. So we indicated on this lo-fi that that image is going to be decorative. So on this one, we don't have to add any alt information to it. If we had decided that that was an informational image or an actionable image, then we would on this screen maybe have an additional alt about this sloth in a bucket. And then we have a little bit more information, like we've decided that we want to make this an H3. So a little bit more information there on the high fidelity. So some of the design tools that I recommend when I'm talking to people who are getting into accessibility, their primary focus is on design. The Accessibility Rocks color palette. I really like this one. This is a tool that helps you visualize an entire palette of all color combinations with accessibility in mind. So the combinations are ordered by color contrast ratio. So it's kind of really cool, especially if you have brand colors or certain colors that you can't get away from. It'll tell you which combinations are the best. The second one, accessibility heuristics, posters, and checklists. We've talked about that one already, about in depth. The color contrast analyzer, this is from the Passiello group and is by far my absolute favorite tool for designers when it comes to accessibility. And the reason why I love it so much is that it's one of the only ones I've found that does it reliably and does not require hex code. So when you're doing the automated testing tools, a lot of times they're testing like hex versus hex, but sometimes like an automated testing tool, it can't detect like text on top of an image or text on top of a gradient. And that's when this tool would come into play, where you could kind of touch with the eyedropper tool and kind of decide, you know, and kind of look at the design. And it doesn't have to go, again, it doesn't have to be code. You could do it on any kind of design system like Sketch or Canvas or Photoshop or whatever, InDesign, whatever you're using, you can use this tool within that. So it's really cool. There's just a one out there too called Contrast Checker that I like. It does some cool stuff like being able to share and doing some great stuff, grayscale stuff. This next group is kind of like emulators. So Chrome Lens, No Coffee, and Funkify. They all do different things like emulating low vision, glaucoma, color blindness. So a lot of different things. Dyslexia. Again, they're sort of like in that gray area of like personas where you don't want to, it's not verbatim. You shouldn't think of it as the gospel truth, but it's something that could help build empathy or kind of get people in that mindset of thinking about people with different abilities and disabilities. So something to keep in mind. And then of course the UK Home Office posters that we mentioned as well. All right, so now it's time for the design team to hand off their mockups to the front-end developers. So depending on the number of people and the types of roles you have at your office, this workflow might look a little bit different. But at some point, basically the design needs to be translated into code. By sharing design wireframes with the dev team as soon as possible and creating a list of all the assets needed for each component, that helps the developers understand a bit about what's expected from the pattern and also allows them to think about potential technical and accessibility issues more deeply. So at the design handoff, the engineer developers are kind of at that stage two where they're kind of building their knowledge base, but then eventually they'll get into that practice stage when they turn that actual pattern into code. So like most developers, before I write one line of code, I do research. If an accessible version of my pattern is already out there, why reinvent the wheel? Of course, you know, there's some also some interesting code out there. So it's important to make sure you get your patterns from reputable sources, not just the first solution that pops up on Stack Overflow or a Google search. The first one is the accessibility style guide. This is a living style guide or pattern library. This is one that I started a few years ago when I was a beginner. It definitely is a very kind of beginner kind of thing, but it's a good reference if you kind of want some more information. I had that card, the flip example that we won't move to it as well. But for something a little bit more robust, we kind of want to look at things like Accessible Components by Scott O'Hara. He is a wealth of information when it comes to components and patterns and the JavaScript king out there, as far as I'm concerned, accessible JavaScript king there. DQ has a couple code libraries. We have a beta code library that's in DQ University. We also have a pattern library called Cauldron. I believe that might be React-based, so it might be a little bit different than the plain JavaScript ones that we have in DQ University. UK Gov and the US Web Systems, anytime you can find a government framework or style guide, they're usually pretty good and robust because they have high regulations. It's usually WCAG, AAA that they're aiming towards. So their patterns are pretty well thorough and tested. We also have Hayden Pickering. A lot of the stuff that he does is really cool. The inclusive components, I know he's kind of moved away from that a little bit, but that's still a good reference, and some other things that he's been doing more lately is they're kind of really interesting. Also various JavaScript frameworks. One thing to check first is if you're using a specific JavaScript framework, I know Angular, React especially, they're very accessible, accessibility focused. So there might be add-ons or documentation that could help you there. Marcy Sutton for Gatsby has done some really amazing things in terms of accessibility. So if you decide that that's the kind of a framework that you guys want to be already using, that's awesome. That's already built in. So definitely think about that. So again, this is stage two, like the knowledge building. And then the stage three. So usually by then I've kind of got a good idea of what kind of pattern I want to get and kind of some reputable sources. And then of course, internal testing that I do on my own. But then, so let's say I find a pattern and usually I can modify the pattern to make it what I want it to be. So I'm just showing you a pattern, part of the pattern that we're working on today, which is the flip card. I think I've got a highlight. So yeah, so we have a flip ID right here, flip four. We have an aria controls equals content, and then an ID that's related. And then just pointing out again, the alt here. Remember back to the lo-fi iteration is that we decided that that sloth image was going to be it was going to be decorative, not informative. So we may want to make sure, just pointing this out again, an alt that is missing is different than an alt that is empty. So empty alt is signaling to a screen reader that this is a decorative image and you can skip over it. Missing alt would flag you on a violation for WCAG requirements. So they're kind of two different things. I just want to point that out. I think sometimes, especially people who are beginning, don't actually know that part either. So I just wanted to point that one out. And some additional relevant JavaScript to this. So some aria controls that we have here. We have some aria hidden. We have some aria expanded for the button and aria expanded false. So some developer tools that we like to point out, the Alley project has a wealth of knowledge and events and all that, but it's also got this great web accessibility checklist. And I point people to this checklist a lot as well, just as a really good reference to kind of get you started, because accessibility can be complex and difficult. And that's the way to kind of make it a little bit more streamlined for people. Alley, Slack, and Twitter, we have a really wonderful community and feel like we can all ask each other anything, you know, there's no dumb questions. It's really a great community that's supporting each other. So if you're not already in the Alley Slack or not active on Twitter, you should take a look at that, because I think that that's invaluable, this and this community especially. So just want to point that one out as well. There's some Aria specs. First rule of Arias, don't use Aria. No, you should use Aria, but you should use it sparingly and responsibly. The WebAIM survey that just came out was surveying, I think it was like a million pages, right? And had found that pages with ARIA had more issues than pages that didn't have ARIA. So again, ARIA is very important and it's useful, but you know you need to have be responsible on how you use it. So these specs are really good for you. HTML5 accessibility, this is also a reference that I point out all the time. Like this is Steve Faulkner's baby, I believe, and Paciello group as well. But I love this one. It also tells developers which HTML5 I can use versus, again, if I need to add supplemental ARIA or if I need to use something completely different, right? So it gives me a lot of more information. I expect that this will be useful in the next iteration of HTML that comes out. Of course, WCAG quick reference guides and tutorials are wonderful. Anything WCAG or Y is really great. All right, so we've tilled the soil, we planted and watered the seeds, and we've let our light in. So now we've done growing our accessible component, right? Well, almost. If our garden isn't tended to, weeds will creep in and take over. And I know not a lot of people like to weed a garden, but it's kind of necessary to task, otherwise your flowers die. And I feel like similarly, accessibility testing is kind of in that group, right? It's not super glamorous, but it's very necessary. It's also one of those things, just like weeding, it's not a one and done activity. Accessibility testing is never done. I'll just say that again. Accessibility testing is never done. So we have new updates to browsers. We have updates to assistive technology devices. We have markup rules that change, code regressions, sprint regressions, right? So all these like factors. And so we should consider accessibility testing an ongoing maintenance task. By setting aside some of these time each month to review accessibility, we can catch mistakes when they're small and easier to manage and fix. So again, when I go to these trainings, people ask me about automatic testing tools and they're like, they're perfect, right? And I just press a button and I summon magical creatures and they go in and find and fix all the issues. I wish that was the reality, but it isn't quite yet. They don't like my answer. I usually say, regardless of the tool or suite of tools, automatic testing can only reliably, statistically, from research, pick up about like 30 to 40% of all accessibility issues. And I know that that number is changing. It's creeping towards 100 as we go, you know, along. And some tools are better picking up some accessibility issues and others might be better suited for catching other errors. So you really need to run the suite of tools. But on top of that, all the issues the automatic testing tools do find, many still do require a human to interpret the results of the and prioritize the issues. An example of that would be like an automated testing tool that might tell you your image is missing alt text, but it can't tell you what alt text to write. So it can be a little bit confusing sometimes. But it's not all bad news, like I mentioned. Good news is automated testing tools are truly amazing and getting smarter with each new version. A quick shout out to Axe Pro. I was able to demo that at a client training this week, and people really loved it because it added some manual tests as well. So I'm hoping that there's going to be a day soon where these tools can reliably catch up to 100% of the issues and even fix them for you. But until then, you can add some UI UX tests, you can add some manual keyboard tests, mobile touch tests, screen reader tests, and other APs as well, assistive technology devices if you have access to them. Content readability test, and what I think is the most important is user tests. You want to make sure you add those to your workflow as well to cover any gaps the automatic testing leaves behind. One also quick thing that I also like to tell people is don't forget to add an accessibility statement, an accessible way for users to contact you about any issue they have with your website or app, because that goes a long way in terms of overall user experience and satisfaction. Also, it's hard to know like all the combinations of all the things that are out there for all the users. So this is a way that you can get that information a little bit easier. All right, so for our little automatic test, I'm gonna take off my headset so we can hear the screen reader. For this quick snippet, I did voiceover on Chrome, which is kind of like a no-no, but we'll just hear it here so we can kind of get a quick example of it. So it's not a super deep test, but I wanted you to hear the voice, voiceover voice. All right.
visited, link, flip click card. You are currently on the heading level 2. True or false, sloths are carnivores, button. You are currently on a button. To click this button, press Control, Options, True or False, sloths are carnivores, false. Sloths mainly eat the tree buds, new shoots, fruit and leaves, of the cecropia tree, expanded, button. True or false, sloths are carnivores, collapsed, button. True or false, sloth.
All right, plugging my head back in. So I like how the voiceover gets the word cecropia tree correct, like the the way you say that one versus sloth, and it always calls it sloth. I think that's kind of cute. But anyway, that's just a quick example showing like what our actual code sounds like. So ideally what we would be doing for that kind of pattern testing is that, again, we would do some automatic testing tools because low hanging fruits, we can catch some really easy things, right? And then beyond that, I'd want to be using touch devices and keyboard to make sure, does this work on like a mobile touch device? Like when I tap it, is it gonna have the same kind of activity? Same with keyboard. You would be amazed when you do audits, like how many accessibility issues you could resolve if you just manually tested with a keyboard. And that consists of you pressing tab, shift tab, if you're fancy, you know, a space bar and enter, right? Escape key sometimes, but like there's a lot of things that you can do with just keyboard testing. So please, you know, that's a very cheap and easy one for everyone to do as well. Screen reader combinations, these are the ones that are recommended by DQ, but other companies might have other recommendations, but we currently say Windows with Chrome and Firefox plus NVDA or IE Edge plus JAWS. For Android, we're talking about Chrome, Firefox plus TalkBack. And for Mac or iOS, we're talking about Safari plus VoiceOver. Because screen readers are built in with a certain browser in mind, they work best with that combination. So when you mix them, like I did in the example of like Chrome and VoiceOver, sometimes you can get some interesting bugs or some false positives, or it looks like it's fine. And then you test it in a different screen reader combination and it doesn't work at all. So it's just things to think about that it's not just, unfortunately not a very straightforward thing. You got a lot of testing here. The WCAG quick reference guide is really great too. You can filter by levels, conformance, tags, like they have a really cool stuff. And this other one called the Web Developer Toolbar, we show a lot, especially for beginners. It can show things like headings or outline table cells, and especially for people who maybe are less comfortable with the inspect code. They don't feel like they have to get into the code as much. So that's a really great one. All right, so now our pattern's in full bloom, but what happened to our stage 4 of understanding? So as we've discussed here, there are different stages of digital accessibility that we're all on. True beginners may not even be at stage 1 awareness, but I'm finding that group rarer and rarer these days. So the word about digital accessibility seems to be out, which is great. That's the first hurdle. But what I'm seeing now is that a lot of people stop at that stage 2 knowledge or stage 3 practice, where you know and you're aware of some of the digital accessibility guidelines and you've got some testing tools in your back pocket. Maybe you know how to fix some of the issues reported, but you haven't quite connected the dots to the humans they impact. So from the standpoint of getting stuff done, honestly, stage 2 and 3 are okay stopping points. But what happens when things that you need to do are super complex for a quick fix, or you don't have any buy-in from your peers or your management? I feel like once we all get to stage 4, that understanding level, we really get why these kinds of changes are needed and people will start being more motivated to make these changes regardless of the challenges involved. And of course, I love this quote from Tim Berners-Lee, "The power of the web is in its universality. Access by everyone regardless of disability is an essential aspect." Because at the end of the day, when we talk about accessibility, what we're really talking about at the core is inclusiveness. And the actual process of writing accessible code and building accessible designs involves rules and standards, tests and tools, but inclusive design and development is more abstract than that. It's that change of thinking. And so when we rethink our approach to design and development, we go beyond the base level of simply code functionality or design. We instead think about how is this element consumed? How can we make it even more intelligible and easier for people to use? So this inclusive development means making something valuable, not just accessible to as many people as we can. So I encourage you to go out with that, that in the back in your mind and these slides and be that change and fix this world one accessible pattern at a time. All right, thank you. If you have any questions, awesome. I'm here on Twitter and LinkedIn. Hopefully we have some questions today, GitHub, and then those are the links to the slides.
Yes, thanks, Carie. There's a huge amount of useful information there. And I'm sure people in the audience are already looking up some of the resources and tools you mentioned. We've got a question from Twitter from Najaya Sabir. How does the accessibility framework / approach differ based on product type, i.e. website, mobile app, e-learning, et cetera?
Yeah, I mean, that's a good question. The quick answer is sometimes it does and sometimes it doesn't. I think when it comes to accessibility testing, that's a lot more difficult on mobile app specific. Like I feel like we're a little bit still in the Wild West when it comes to that. So I think the web-based and if, you know, like a responsive site, so you could have a mobile version of that, right? Like those are easy to test and those are easier to implement than I think like a mobile specific app. That's my experience. I'm not sure if you've seen something similar, but yeah, hopefully that answered your question. But
one question I had is,
sure.
Is there a particular design pattern that you've come across that you found harder than the rest to implement and get really right?
Yeah, I mean, there's always, yes, there's like a ton, right? So we have, of course, carousels, which maybe you shouldn't be using those in general. You could argue that from a design perspective, but like those are difficult. Modals are always difficult. I think for some, we have a lot of keyboard trap issues. And I call all the time forms kind of like the holy grail of accessibility because they're so hard. They're so difficult to get right, like 100%, right? Because you're talking about error prevention and then you're talking about what happens when an error happens, like how do you remediate that like in the best way? And silence is deadly when you're using a screen reader. And if you're not telling a screen reader user that they pressed a button and they're sitting there waiting, but they're actually being timed out, right? Like, mm-hmm. But you haven't told them that. So there's a lot there. So I think forms are hard, and especially because a lot of times we're adding personal data or you can be like anxious about it, right? If like you're signing for a new credit card or a loan or something, or mm-hmm. right? So, I mean, you have that level of anxiety on top of everything else. So I think that forms are very difficult.
You mentioned the GovUK platform as being a good example of things. And what's your opinion of their very simple, you know, almost one question, perhaps two at a time approach? Do you think that sort of alleviates some of the kind of anxiety that people have from
form specifically?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I mean, we talked about that too, in the sense of, if you have 50 steps, is that really helping the cognitive load, like spreading it out? So I think it's all dependent on the context, right? So if you had something that made sense to break up into chunks, as long as you have that last kind of summary page where you're reiterating all the things that you've inputted or chosen, right, throughout the form, I think that would be fine. But again, like, it's just like having a giant long form versus a form with 50 steps. Like at that point, from a design perspective, you have to think maybe there's a better way to do this. But again, there's probably some context in there that would be useful.
Makes sense.
What guidance can you give on how designers and developers can communicate effectively about accessibility?
See, that's a good question. I don't feel like, maybe I think I'm one of those people who's more of a UX engineer, because I really feel that design is so important to accessibility. And I feel like we don't talk about that part enough because we're so focused on the code because it's sexy, right? It does things and it looks cool. But the design is like the backbone to everything, right? And I remember when I was a front-end developer getting designs from designers who had no idea about accessibility versus ones that did. And it was like night and day. And the ones that knew about accessibility, I could go back to them as a developer and say, hey, this contrast isn't quite right. Can I just change this hex a little bit, right? As long as it's not a brand color, usually they were fine with it. But if they were a designer who didn't understand why I'm asking for this, then there would be a lot of pushback. So again, I think that having that communication, having everyone, you know, obviously we need this, the management and everybody to trickle down as well. But I talk about that as it shouldn't be a requirement. It should be a priority, and it should be a company priority, right? It's intrinsic in every aspect of every department, right? So then when I come back as a developer to the designer, then I don't feel like I'm doing something bad, or I'm not just changing things on my own without the design input, right? It's a communication, and it's like a team effort to get the accessibility, best accessible product out there.
Right. Yeah. I think it's an overused term, but it's like having a culture of accessibility is sort of the best mm-hmm. way to do this long term and with the most success.
Very true.
Mm-hmm. One more question.
Sure.
Might be a tricky one. Is there anything you can suggest to help teams estimate the level of effort they need to put into accessibility testing for features of different complexities?
Yeah, I mean, that's difficult for sure to answer. It would depend on a lot of the patterns that you're specifically choosing. But I think one point that I could make is that if you're doing this from the beginning, from the design process on down, it's going to be a lot easier before if you get to the very end and it's like a QA thing and you get an audit, you know, you get litigation. Unfortunately, that also happens. So that's a stressful situation. You know, you're about to release the next day and you've got something that's not accessible and it's so broken you can't put it out there, like a keyboard trap, for instance, or something that's causing seizures, or, you know, your users to become sick where it's obviously a big blocker. And so you don't want to get to that point. You want to catch these bugs when they're small. So I think that's part of it too. It's just, I mean, simple communication in some ways, right, is key to some of that. But yeah, I don't have any short answers for that. I guess we'll have to take that conversation onto Twitter after the fact and kind of get into some of the ideas.
Very difficult. I agree. Okay, I think that's all for the questions. Cool. Let me just check Skype one last time.
While you're doing that, I'll just shout out a quick reminder that if you like Carie's talk, please do head over to youtube.com/inclusivedesign24 and hit that like button. And while you're there, why not subscribe to the channel so you'll get all the notifications about everything that's taking place there. Any more questions, Ian? Or?
No, that's it.
Okay, in awesome. That case, I will say a big thank you to Carie and also to Gold supporters at Intopia and Barclays Access, our Silver supporters at Siteimprove and Adobe, and our Bronze supporters, Pasiello Group, DQ Systems, and Samsung Internet. We will be right back on the hour with Russ Weekly, who'll be talking about a very hot topic of the moment, design systems, and specifically states within them. So don't go away.